Welcome to Backstage with Becca B, with special guest, Justin Sargent. Hi everyone, and welcome to this episode of Backstage with Becca B. On this episode, on top of his impressive list of regional credits, such as West Side Story, For the Record Love Actually, and For the Record Baz, Pippin, Rocky Horror, Jesus Christ Superstar, and more. He has also starred as Peter Parker in Spiderman Turn Off the Dark, Drew in Rock of Ages, and been in Bonnie and Clyde on Broadway. Please welcome Justin Sargent.
Hi, how's it going?
Good, how are you?
I'm doing great.
Love the energy.
How are you doing?
Doing great, too. It's been a crazy past year, but getting through it. You know?
You're telling me. Oh my goodness. Yes, it has been. Where are you? Where do you live? Where are you located?
Normally in California, but right now I'm in Dallas, Texas.
Dallas, Texas. Oh my goodness. Yeah. All right.
Yep.
Are you Los Angeles? Is that in California where you live in? Or where you're from?
I was in Studio City. I'd been there since 2015. I actually just saw like the anniversary post of when I moved into my college dorm 6 years ago, and I've been living there ever since. So.
Oh, nice. Awesome.
But yeah, that's me. So, how have you been with this time period?
Oh my God. Well, it's been so long. It's been such a long time period. It's been, you know, what is it? It's been 10 months now, I think, right?
Computer, yeah.
As of last week. Oh my God. I've been good. You know, I've been keeping busy. A lot of projects, you know, I'm sure we'll get into some like, you know, career stuff, you know, later on, but mostly just working on, there's a lot of shows that are in development that I've got my hands in. And so, yeah, so a lot of those creators are taking time right now to, you know, work on those shows and kind of do little Zoom readings of, even if it's just like a couple of scenes just to see how they work. So it's actually really cool. I'm very excited to see where a lot of these things end up once theaters are open, because these writers have had so much time to kind of focus in, you know, and
exactly
make changes. But I've just been doing that. I have a little baby girl, and aww. So yeah, and so it's been a lot of daddy daughter time, because my wife has a full-time job. She works for you actually might know what it is. It's called VidCon. Have you heard of VidCon?
Oh, what, like, wait, VidCon?
Yeah,
like, yeah.
So she produces VidCon for all the international markets. So she works on the show here in the U.S. and she's the executive producer of VidCon International. So,
whoa.
Yeah, it's that's kind of a crazy, crazy job that she ended up. So you know, she's oh my God, I'm so tongue tied right now. I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
So she's still working full time. So during the day, it's, you know, it's me and Luna.
Oh, that's so much fun.
Yeah.
And it's something that probably wouldn't happen if we weren't in this whole, like, quarantine situation. You wouldn't get to spend this much time with her.
100%, because, you know, I was 2 weeks away from starting rehearsals for a new show in New York, and we were going to be running it for at least 5 or 6 months, and then transferring to Broadway in the late fall of this past year. And so had that happened, you know, she would have been in daycare. She would have had a, you know, like not a nanny, but like at least like a babysitter, you know, during the day. And so we've got to really spend a lot of time, you know, with her in this really crucial young developmental age. It's been amazing. It's been really, really wonderful. It's very, very tiring, but you know.
I can imagine. How old is she? Like young.
She's 15 months.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
And that's when they start like walking and stuff. So it's like you're like chasing her around.
She's walking, she's running, she's all over the place. We were living in a two-bedroom apartment in Sunnyside, Queens, and we were just like, that's it. We gotta get out. We gotta get a house. So we moved out to West Orange, New Jersey. And this area is like it's referred to as like Broadway West, because so many people live out here when they have kids, you know, like there's so many people that live like within a 2 or 3 mile range of me. It's kind of insane.
It's close enough to New York, but
Exactly. And you can have a house and a yard and, you know.
Yeah.
And the commute time is only really like 10 minutes longer because, you know, the train from here is only about 25 minutes into Penn Station,
wow.
Port Authority. I don't remember which one. I haven't done it yet because we just moved here like a month ago. So I haven't gone.
Yeah, that's convenient.
On the train. Yeah.
So before I get into more theater, what's the show that you were working on and gonna be doing on Broadway? Can you talk about it?
Yes, I can. I'd love to. And I'd love to promote it if I can, yes. if you don't mind. It's called Super You.
Okay.
SuperYouTheMusical.com. It is so badass. It is, do you know Kennedy Coghill? Do you know that actress?
Yes.
Redhead, she was just playing Carole King on Beautiful on the
Road. I've heard so many good things.
She's amazing. And so she's the star and I play her co-star, her boyfriend, kind of abusive boyfriend in the show.
Ooh.
It's a new rock musical. Yeah, it's all about this young woman who kind of has a lot of, you know, family tragedy, a lot of things in her life are not going so well. And her brother dies in this terrible car accident. It's a whole thing. So she's dealing with a lot of grief and a lot of sadness and a lot of like kind of she's kind of lost herself. And the kind of like theme throughout the show is that she has, oh boy, it's a lot to explain. So her brother, her older brother, and her grew up in a foster home.
Okay.
Their parents died when they were both young. So they grew up in a foster home and he's this amazing comic book illustrator. And he kind of encourages her to, kind of express her feelings through art and through drawing. And so she creates these six superheroes that are all women that are part of her personalities personality attributes that she doesn't have herself. Right.
Wow.
And so they all like jump off the page and like they infiltrate her real life. And like, of course, only she can see them. And so when her brother dies, she kind of abandons all of them and they kind of disappear from her life. And she kind of throws herself into like meaningless jobs and, you know, kind of like data analysis and just kind of whatever. And then she meets this struggling musician who's dealing with his own stuff. And she kind of like loses herself in him in a way. And it starts to become very kind of emotionally abusive. And then her comic book creations come back to her. And like, no, remember who you are, remember where you come from, remember how strong you are, this kind of thing. And that's kind of the launching point of the show. And then it's pretty badass. The music is so good.
I can imagine that kind of sounds like it'd be like almost as emotional as like a show like Next to Normal or do you have
any? It's so funny you mentioned that because that is exactly what I always compare it to Next to Normal. I'm sorry, I'm dealing with a little voice. My voice is all like weird.
You're all good.
It's winter. But yeah. It is very much like Next to Normal. There's a lot of dramatic, you know, tension and a lot of kind of deep, excavating a lot of deep emotion in the show. But there's also a lot of fun. And there's these six badass, you know, comic book hero heroines that get to, you know, come on the stage and like shoot fire out of their hands and all kinds of cool stuff. It's awesome.
I'm sure it's gonna do amazing. And I can't wait to get to see it on Broadway when theater comes back.
Yeah.
Broadway.
There's also a full like a demo album that came out on Spotify during quarantine. It's all old stuff from like back when they first started developing the show about 7 years ago. So but it's worth listening. It's pretty damn good. It's pretty damn good.
It's crazy that it takes like that long for shows to be fully developed and like picked up.
Oh yeah.
Like it must be exhausting for the people who go through that creative process to write songs and write the show. And it's like, okay, is the show going to take off? Like, what's going to happen? Do I keep working on it? Like, those people who never give up on what they're writing and believe in their project.
100%. And the woman who wrote it, her name is Lourdes Lane. And she has this foundation called the Super You Foundation. And it's all about reaching out to kids with disabilities. And so she shows up at like schools and different organizations and like brings a box full of, you know, like superhero costume elements and they kind of like create their own superheroes and she sings songs. It's so badass. And so it's she wrote the book, the music, she wrote everything. She's literally a genius, like went to Harvard or whatever in one of those schools.
Oh my goodness, I love that so much. And I'm gonna put all the links that I can find about the show in the description of this.
Yes.
So for anyone watching. Well, anyways, to backtrack a little bit, or a lot, when was the first time you realized you had a passion for musical theater and wanted to be an actor?
Oh man, so when I was growing, I grew up in Florida. I grew up in Tampa Bay area in Florida, and I had moved from I moved to a new town, a new city, in the middle of eighth grade year.
Oh,
and and so, you know, kind of had to say goodbye to a lot of my friends and make new friends, this whole thing. And I had an English teacher who was involved in the community theater. And she was like, hey, if you're looking for a way to make new friends and to meet people. And I was also, you know, kind of a class, not a class clown, but very boisterous and outspoken and always volunteered to read things, that kind of stuff. And she was like, oh, I think you'd have a lot of fun doing community theater. And so I auditioned for Oliver at the Richie Suncoast Theater in Newport Richie, Florida, and got cast as the Artful Dodger. And that was it. And like, as soon as that happened, it was just like, bam, that's what I want to do. And I, you know, I do a lot of master classes, and I do a lot of, outreach to educational programs all over the country. And one thing I always encourage the students to do is to join a community theater, or at least go see shows there, because the thing that really, you know, impassioned me about theater was that these people were all there, the adults were all there doing it for free, you know? They were all volunteering. They were, you know, doctors or working at the pharmacy or working at the grocery store during the day. And then at night they were spending hours rehearsing and putting on shows for free, you know, because they loved it. And so it was a great way to find mentors and a great way to kind of, you know, figure out that this is what I want to do for the rest of my life.
Yeah. And like making money is like fantastic and necessary, but it's great to be around people probably who truly have the passion and love for what they're doing and don't just do it for like the reason that they're making money. Like
100%. Yeah.
I mean, you want a job because like you want to make that money, but still. So what was the first like theater show you ever saw?
Oh, it was Peter Pan at the Fox Theater in Atlanta, Georgia. And it blew my mind. And when we had to clap for Tinkerbell, I was like, this is the best thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Oh my God. Yes. It's like clapping for, it's like clapping at the end of Defying Gravity.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Tinkerbell. Yep.
Yeah. Wow. It was amazing. Yep, that was the first thing I ever saw. Yeah.
And it's like a Disney movie, so it's like something that you probably saw as a kid, and
I'm sure.
Transferred to the stage, like.
Yeah, and then I would go see the Disney movies in the theaters, like. You know, Lion King was really big when I was growing up. Hunchback of Notre Dame was huge. I love that. It was like one of the first movies I saw where they said the word hell, and I was like, oh, this is dangerous. You know? What's that?
Me in seventh grade when I heard that word in song lyrics.
Disney, they're selling it. They're selling it.
Oh yeah. So you went to University of Central Florida to study theater. Why did you choose to go there and like stay close to home to study theater?
Well, so I knew I wanted to stay in the state because I had, in Florida, they have what's called a Florida Bright Future Scholarship, where if you are able to achieve a certain GPA, then a certain percentage of your tuition is paid for. So I knew I had to go to an in-state school because I wanted to, I didn't want to rack up a bunch of student debt, and I didn't want to have to rely on my parents, and while they were more than willing to help me out with whatever I needed, and they were always very supportive and still are, I just kind of felt like I wanted to stay close to home and close to my friends, and so I auditioned actually for UCF, I auditioned for UF, FSU, and Flagler College, and I am not a strong dancer. So FSU was like, we're going to stick with some of the better dancers. So UCF, actually the first time I auditioned for their program, I didn't get in. So I didn't get in. And what's that?
So you tried again, obviously.
So I tried again. Well, yeah, they said, we can tell that there's something there, and, we appreciate the talent, but the dancing is kind of a big deal. Can you work on the dancing and come back? And so, you know, it's a 4-year program, no matter when you start. So I thought, oh God, really, is this gonna be a 5-year college experience for me? And I'm gonna have to come back and audition after a year, because they only do auditions once a year, you know?
Yeah.
And so I did. I spent a year as a BA, was loving it because it's such a well-rounded degree, because it's not just performance-based. It's not just focused on performing. It's focused on like the entire spectrum of what makes theater theater, right? Was really enjoying it and working on dancing. And, you know, so I took some extra dance classes for electives and kind of, you know, got a little tiny bit better and auditioned the next year. And they were like, well, you're still not a very good dancer, but you're better than you were. So, you know, we think we can, you know, we can help you along. And and that was it. And so then I got accepted the next year. And I loved my time at UCF.
They saw you put in the effort, and through learning how, like through teaching yourself how to dance and learning how to dance more, you probably have a larger skill set now, even if you still think you aren't the best dancer. Like, I'm sure it's helped you in a lot of the shows you've done.
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, Rock of Ages, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of dancing, but there was some like, there was some dancing going on, you know?
Yeah, and
I still remember all those moves too. I still remember Motorman. You know, I remember all that stuff. Yeah.
And I don't think I could ever pick up any of that dancing. So much better than like a lot of people out there could do.
It took some effort. It took a lot of effort.
I mean, but doesn't everything, like if you're passionate, like if you're learning how to master something, it takes effort.
Yeah, totally.
So what was the most valuable thing besides that dance experience that you learned at University of Central Florida?
Ooh, good question. The most valuable thing that I learned, kind of, you know, not just don't be a, can I curse? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Just don't be an asshole. You know what I mean? Like, don't be a jerk. Don't be, you know, be somebody that everybody wants to work with. You know, there's no reason for anybody to ever be dismissive, or for anybody to be, you know, unkind, or if you don't want to be there, then don't be there. You know what I mean? Like, there's so much of that attitude. I feel like in this business, you work with some people and they're just like, it's like, why are you here? What are you doing here? Like you obviously aren't happy, you know? And so, they actually did a really good job of instilling that into us. It's like, look, if you want to do this, you better act like you want to do this. You know what I'm saying? Like it was, and so that was a very valuable lesson for me. Not that I necessarily needed that lesson, but I have definitely thought back to those days as I've gone through my career and just been like, wow, like I'm grateful to be where I am and to be able to do what it is I'm doing. And, never take it for granted. So I would say that, above all the different, you know, kind of performance techniques and all this kind of stuff, which were all over the place and wonderful. I think the most valuable lesson I learned as a performer and as a human, honestly, was just be grateful and enjoy it.
I love that, and it's necessary.
Yeah,
love what you do.
What you do, or get out.
Yeah. So. Going forth, how did University of Central Florida prepare you for your professional career, and how soon after did you start like booking, because you've booked a lot of big Broadway stuff and regional theater, how soon after did you start booking stuff consistently?
One thing that UCF is very kind of adamant about is that when you are in school, you are not auditioning for professional jobs. You are there to learn, you know, and it's considered a conservatory program. So there's a lot of work to be done. I did have to work. I worked at Blockbuster and a restaurant called Payway through all my college career.
I know Payway.
Yeah, hell yeah, Payway. Yes. What you get? So good. It was very, very, very focused on kind of like operating as a professional theater would, you know, in rehearsals and in the classroom. And so I started working once I graduated. I started working at the theme parks in Orlando, and so I worked at Universal Studios for two seasons of Halloween Horror Nights. They did this Rocky Horror Show live on stage, kind of a thing. It was like a 45-minute version of the Rocky Horror Show. So I played Riff Raff. I had a bald cap and a wig and everything. It was awesome. And we would do like 7 to 8 hours of shows a night. Like it would be, I'd show up at like 5 o'clock and like sometimes I'd get home at like 2 o'clock in the morning and our last show would be like at 1 a.m., you know, that kind of thing. Yeah, it was awesome.
Wow, that's insanity. But that seems so fun to get to go like work at the theme parks.
Yeah, so I did that. I worked at SeaWorld. Do you know Rachel Potter by any chance?
Yes.
So Rachel and I, we co-hosted a ski show. Called the Bayside Ski Jam at SeaWorld. And we were just like spouting out a bunch of information about like different kinds of jumps and equipment that we had no idea what we were talking. We just memorized the script, you know, of course. And you got to sing like, rhythm is gonna get you, you know, like kind of cheesy music. And yeah. And you know, I did a lot of, you know, kind of corporate entertainment stuff there in Orlando. And then Spiderman was coming through Orlando because they were looking for somebody to be the alternate for Reeve. And so a bunch of my friends were like, dude, you look like Peter Parker. You sing rock music pretty much exclusively. You have to go to audition for this. And so I auditioned and went through all the rounds of callbacks, even the final callbacks in New York, and didn't book it. And Bernard Telsey from Telsey and Company, for those that don't know, it's like one of the largest casting companies in the city or in the world, actually. And he after my audition, he came out and was like, you know, do you have any plans of moving to New York? And I said, I mean, eventually. And he's like, you should do it sooner than later. So I was so green. I had no idea what I was doing. Like, I brought my girlfriend with me to the audition. Like, I had never done anything like this before in my life. So,
yeah.
Like, before my audition, I was like, oh, I just have to say, Miss Tamor, I'm a really big fan, and it's really great to be here. And I was like, I must have looked so, like, just dumb and young and whatever. But,
yeah, you're still young after college, and you're excited to, like, go into the real world. So,
yeah. And, like, it was probably my fourth, like, professional audition of any kind. You know, let alone a big for like a Broadway show. So yeah, so I didn't get it, but they Bernard Telsey asked me if I had plans to move to the city, and I said eventually. He said do it sooner than later. So 6 months later, I showed up in New York and emailed him. I was like, hey, I'm here, you know, and that was it, you know. And then it was just kind of like he held up his end of the promise, and he started calling me in for stuff. And yeah.
Wow. So when you booked your first role in New York, what was your reaction? Was it Bonnie and Clyde the first thing you got?
No, actually the first thing I got was Rock of Ages.
Okay.
Back when Rock of Ages was still at the Brooks Atkinson Theater, they had Jeff Packard was the swing on that show, and he was leaving Rock of Ages to go do something else in DC with Laura Molina. I can't remember what it was. And so they were both leaving the show. And so I had auditioned for the tour. And so they called me and said, hey, we want to hire you for the tour, but we you know, figured we'd offer you Broadway instead. And I was like, bah-huh.
Okay.
So, you know, I had the long hair. And so they hired me pretty much primarily to cover Constantine. And so,
wow. And
so, yeah, so I was his understudy for the last, oh gosh, I don't know, 5-6 months of the run at the Brooks Atkinson. And then the show closed there. And then I booked Bonnie and Clyde after that as an understudy for Clyde and for Buck. And then that show closed after 30 days, which was, you know, devastating. It was heartbreaking. But after that show closed, Rock of Ages called and said, hey, you know, would you want to come back to the show now that it's at the Helen Hayes and play Drew? And I was like, hell's yes. So yeah, so I played Drew for had to have been like close to somewhere in between 500 and 600 performances.
Wow.
Yeah, just over a year and a half.
But you got the understudy experience pretty quick into moving to New York. So what was
that? Yeah.
What was the challenge of learning how to be an understudy? And were you a swing too ever, or were you just an understudy?
Yeah, so I was a swing in Rock of Ages, and also in Bonnie and Clyde. But it's so funny how, you know, each show structures their understudies and their swings differently. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like certain roles, you know, the swing will have, you know, the first, I don't even know what you call it, like the, like first, their first call for that role. And yeah, so like when it came to Rock of Ages and it came to like the dance role, like Joey Primo, I was like the third person on the list to play that role. So I got to be a swing and understudy, and they're very difficult jobs. A good friend of mine is, I like to lovingly refer to him as Broadway's super swing. His name's Tony LaPage.
Okay.
And he was a swing in Rock of Ages as well, throughout the entire run of the Helen Hayes. So for like 4.5 years, something like that, he covered every single male role in the show, from Franz, who's supposed to be like 17-ish, all the way to Hertz, who's supposed to be in his 50s, you know? And he's currently, well, until the pandemic, he was the swing on Come From Away, the male swing.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I think I've heard his name before.
Yeah, he's phenomenal. He is just a legit chameleon. He can literally fill in anybody's shoes and skin. It's like,
yeah,
it's crazy.
Swings and understudies are MVPs.
Oh, 100%. He has, without a doubt, the hardest job on Broadway. Like, I would put his job up against anybody's, performance-wise.
Yes, for sure. So, when you got the call to be takeover as Drew in Rock of Ages, what was your reaction? Initially, because that's an iconic role.
Yeah. So I was actually out doing, I was touring a little mini tour of kind of the Northeast with a Queen symphonic show. I was singing Queen music with a live symphony with a couple of good friends. And I was actually I'll never forget, I was backstage and we were in the middle of rehearsal and I got the phone call and I was like, oh my God. And then I got to go out and sing. I want to say it was like We Are the Champions or something, but it was probably like, Tie Your Mother Down or something. But yeah, it was awesome.
And you do have a rock voice, but I feel like you also like have a voice that like has a range, and you can like sing a lot of songs because like you've done shows where it's not just rock. How do you work on that range and like be able to sing pretty much almost anything? Like any role that someone would cast you in?
So I come from a very much, you know, rock and roll music background. You know, like my family, my parents raised me on The Who and Led Zeppelin and The Beatles and, you know, all the great rock and roll, you know, icons. And so rock and roll is my passion. Rock music is my passion. And telling a story through rock and roll is really what I love to do, and that's kind of why I've really wanted to kind of corner that part of the market in musical theater. I want to be, you know, known for doing rock musicals, and so that's kind of what it had influenced the way that I learned to sing and the way that I have learned to cultivate my own voice. But I quickly learned that diversity is a pretty big deal in this business, and so you have to be willing and able to kind of jump into different shoes. And so a lot of it just kind of came from listening to different singers that I thought were just incredible. You know, Steve Barton, he was one of the original Mariuses in Les Mis. He passed away about like, I think a decade or so ago. He's just this amazing baritone, just a classic musical theater voice. And just like, I latched onto him. Bob Cuccioli, who's now a great friend of mine, which just kind of blows my mind because I grew up like idolizing this man and his voice. You know, Jekyll and Hyde, I mean, like, come on, it's just like
you get to like I grew up listening to you singing.
Yeah, oh, we've had many discussions about it, and it's always kind of funny. He gets very embarrassed when I sing his praises, but yeah, so you know, I just kind of listened to all these, you know, great singers that I felt like I would like to emulate and kind of borrowed from them and learned how they were shaping their vowels and how they were, you know, shaping their musical phrases and how, you know, kind of watching them sing and figuring out how they're breathing, this kind of stuff. And so when it came time to do Tony in West Side Story, I did that show in Sacramento Music Circus.
Okay. Yes.
I had to borrow from that, you know, kind of research that I had done just to be able to make sure that I wasn't, you know, disgracing disgracing. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
The stage with my rock voice.
So that's impressive that you have learned to not only sing rock but can sing everything, but you have like the rock voice is like so like it's so natural and effortless. I listened to the video of you singing Don't Stop Believing before this and I was like, it like sounds like he's not even like you can tell that he's trying, but it sounds like it's like effortless and it doesn't like even like it's like gymnasts when they're flipping. And like you're like, how are they doing that and making it look easy? You're like making it sound easy.
Yeah, vocal gymnastics, right? Yeah.
Yeah, you make
which,
it.
Which video was that you saw?
I think it was like 6 years ago, maybe.
Was it, did I have long hair or was it short hair and like a gray?
I think you had shorter hair in it.
Oh man, so I think that's from I did this concert. It was like a Broadway Loves Orlando for the Pulse nightclub shooting.
It was that.
I'll never forget that because this is my, like, this is an audience of 2,000 of my friends and, like, people that I grew up with, and they were all there, and, like, this is my, like, it was, like, a big homecoming for me. It was so, I've never been more nervous in my entire life than singing that song.
Really?
For those people under those circumstances, 100%, because we were there, you know, to honor the victims of the victims of this massacre, and, you know, and it happened in this, Pulse was the first ever, club of any kind that I had ever been to. Like, you know, it was the first, you know, being in a musical theater program, of course, it's, you know, kind of like you're done with the day, you go out and have a good time and party, and that's where they wanted to go. So that's where we went. And it was on the, I mean, I can still picture those rooms. And so it was a very emotional day for me. So I appreciate the kind words about that performance, but it's one of those that I watched and I'm like, oh God.
Well, it sounds so effortless, and it's amazing how you.
Well, thank you.
How do you play characters that other people have played so much in the past, and kind of like put your own spin on it? Then, like iconic characters, because you've also played Peter Parker in Spiderman, which like is known for like anyone who's read the comic books knows Spiderman. Anyone who sees the movies knows Spiderman. Like it's known. Very few people don't know what Spider-Man is.
Totally. And this has kind of, you know, been the, this has kind of been the whole struggle with my career for the last few years is that, you know, I started as an understudy and as a swinging understudy. And then I you know, replaced in two roles on Broadway. And I kind of started feeling like, man, I'm having a hard time, you know, being able to express my voice and what it is that I want to bring to the table and to the stage, right? And so my manager and I had at the time had discussed, you know, let's find a show that you can develop your own character, you know what I mean? And be, and make it, sorry, there's a truck going by. Sorry about that.
No problem.
You know, and make your voice be the voice that other people will have to, you know, emulate from here on out.
Yeah.
So that's what I've been focusing on, because it is difficult, you know, it is, because you do have to fill in somebody's shoes. And while you're given a little bit of freedom and liberty to make it your own, you really do have to you have to respect what's come before, right? And it's a big challenge, because, you know, like when I stepped into Constantine's shoes, you know, he was working with a cast for years that was used to the way he did the show, right? And he was so brilliant in that role, and just so, like, you know, he brought so much sweetness and kindness, and he was so aloof and wonderful, and so people were used to playing off of that character in that specific way. So there's not really much I could do, you know. So I kind of had to adhere to what had come before me, And I loved doing it. I loved every second of it. It's one of my favorite roles of all time. Same thing with Spider-Man, you know. The only difference with that show is that when Reeve left the show, they were kind of trying to figure out, you know, how to, they kind of wanted to make the show a little more kid-friendly. And
okay.
So a lot of the big dramatic moments were kind of being, we were looking to like downplay them a little bit, you know. So that was kind of fun because we got to kind of explore some new territory there, but it was, they were trying to figure it out. It just didn't really work very well. And so, but yeah, it was more of the same kind of, you know, filling in someone else's shoes and trying to make sure that the show was staying this, you know, towing the same line. And so, the last 6 years, 5 or 6 years now, I've been mostly focused on, you know, workshops of new shows, developing new characters, this kind of thing. And it's going extremely well. And like you said before, it takes a long time for these things to make it to the stage. So.
It does, but I feel like it's probably worth it in the end.
Yeah, totally.
Have you had anyone come up to you after shows like Rock of Ages and Spider-Man and be like, I love how you, like any repeat audience members come up and be like, I like how you portrayed this differently or like this differently.
Yeah, especially with Rock of Ages, because that show had so many super fans. I mean, there were a few fans. There's one fan named Abe Calamag, who had seen the show over 500 times, you know.
Wow.
And so he would say, even performance to performance of my own performances, he'd be like, oh, I like how you did this differently than last night. And I'm like, oh, you know, like it's kind of crazy that he notices those things. But yeah, that happens all the time.
That's what makes live theater so special, is getting to see other people perform and take on certain characters. Like, I don't know, I love that, going to see a show multiple times and like seeing an understudy on one night and then a different understudy on the next night and then the normal lead on the next night and be like, oh, this is how they play the characters differently. This is what I like.
Yeah.
Like, I like this, how they play this or say this line differently.
100%.
What was the first time putting on the Spider-Man suit like for you? Was it like, wow? Because were you a fan as a child growing up of Spider-Man?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
100%, yeah. Massive fan, massive nerd. I'm a huge comic book fan. I just moved into this house, and so when my parents, you know, they were like, oh good, you're out of an apartment now, we can bring all your boxes of crap that we have still on the and you know in our basement. So I've got all my comic books and action figures from when I was a kid all downstairs right now, and like I gotta figure out what to do with them, you know. But yeah, massive Star Wars fan, big Star Trek fan, big Marvel fan. Just I can't describe to you that feeling of putting that costume on the first time. It never got old. Every single night, there was a moment in the show where I had to make this incredibly fast, quick change at the end of the show. And I had to go from the Peter Parker costume into the Spidey costume. And I'll never forget, every single time it was like a 1 minute quick change into the suit, and then climb up a ladder, get hooked into something, and then do like this big like drop onto the stage. And every single night that I did it, I'd be climbing the ladder, and as I'm climbing the ladder, I'm looking at my hands and I'm like, oh my god, I'm Spider-Man.
Like, I'm, yeah, really Spider-Man.
Yeah, it was, I mean, like, and I'm climbing up a, you know, wall right now. It was unbelievable. Yeah, it was unbelievable. And I tried to buy one of the suits, but they were like, well, that'll be $6,000, and I was like, no, I'm good.
Did any of the Marvel creators have a hand in the musical ever?
I don't believe so. I know that they eventually were trying to get a comic book tie-in, but I don't think that they were involved. No, I don't think Marvel, because this is before the MCU. This is before Marvel Studios was even a thing.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I mean, really. So. So no, they didn't. The only person that ever came around was the guy that wrote The Amazing Spider-Man, the one with Andrew Garfield.
Oh,
he came to see the show a couple times. Yeah. No, I don't think Marvel was really. Oh, and Stan Lee, of course, came and saw the show, which is kind of cool.
But, wow. Did you meet him backstage?
Very, very briefly. Actually, I got to meet Brian May from Queen. We hung out for like an hour before the show one night. It was kind of cool.
Oh. That's mind-blowing. Do you have a favorite backstage experience from any show you've been in, like someone you've met backstage who you were like, whoa, this person came to see me in a show?
I gotta say, Brian May was pretty incredible. We got to see Journey came to Rock of Ages with a new lead singer that they had found, and so that was pretty incredible. I mean, God, yeah, I mean, I've gotten to work on so many amazing shows that have attracted so many musicians. I mean, so I did Jesus Christ Superstar live on NBC. And so I got to work with you know, John Legend and Alice Cooper and all those guys. And so it was, you know, there were celebrities showing up to that all the time. Angela Weber, actually kind of have a pretty good Angela Weber story if you want to hear it.
Yes, please. Right. And I have to ask you about Jesus Christ Superstar and what it's like filming a musical for television.
It's pretty crazy. It's pretty good. Let me preface it by saying it's pretty crazy.
I can imagine. It's different than being on stage and having an audience come because, like, there's cameras all around.
Kind of, but you know what's really weird is that when we actually did the live performance, we didn't, the cameras were so seamlessly integrated into what we were doing that it felt like we were doing a show. I mean, it really did. It was so incredible. I mean, like, aside from the commercial breaks, everything would stop and we kind of just kind of like breathe for a second, like look around and the audience was like cheering and stuff like that. Aside from that, it really didn't feel any different than doing a live show.
And there was an audience too, right?
Yeah, it was a full audience, yeah.
So that probably helped.
There's no way I could possibly ever explain how cool that night was. It was the coolest night of my entire life. It was so amazing.
Well, what's the Andrew Lloyd Webber story? Because like,
okay, legend. So I was hired to be in the production, to play one of the priests and to be in the ensemble, but I was also hired because John Legend was, it was about a 7.5 week rehearsal process from our first rehearsal to the night we went live. And so John was only there for the first like week and a half and like the last 2 weeks.
What?
So, yeah, I mean, so, you know, he's John Legend. He was touring. I think he was in Taiwan. He was like, he was all over the world. What's that? Say it again.
He's doing 500 things at once.
Oh, yeah. And having a baby at the same time. Like, his wife was like very pregnant. And like, they actually even had a contingency plan. Like, well, if she gives birth, we're going to have to, you know, like postpone, do it the next week, whatever. So I was hired to be his understudy or rehearsal stand-in or whatever you want to call it. So when he was gone, I was playing Jesus. And so for all of the run-throughs and all of the, you know, all the rehearsals before we went into the studio, I was playing his role and kind of getting it all figured out with the whole crew and the whole cast. And so for 5 weeks, I got to kind of step into his shoes, which was amazing. So I got to do, you know, I got to do all the scenes with Sarah Bareilles and Brandon Victor Dixon and all these people. And so famously, there is this song that has been they've been trying to get into the show for a long time. They had always intended
the show.
What's that?
The stage version of the show for a long time.
Yeah. So there's this song that Angela Weber and Tim Rice had always been trying to add in between Dance for All Time and The Last Supper.
Okay.
And they thought, well, this might be a cool opportunity to do that, you know, like just like to, you know, feature this brand new song for this big, huge live event. And so after rehearsal one day, they said, Justin, Sarah, and Brandon, tomorrow you guys are going to go into the studio. Angela Dupper is going to come and you guys, the four of you are going to go into a studio and he's going to teach you this song and you guys need to record it so we can send it off to John so he can learn it. And I was like, excuse me? We're going to do what? What now?
With
and
who?
So I'd met him briefly, you know, a couple days before because he was there. And so we were like singing What's the Buzz and like all this kind of stuff. And I was getting to sing Jesus. And so I got to meet him, you know, very briefly then. But like I was about to spend a day with him, like in a rehearsal studio.
Yeah.
And not just with him, but with Sarah Bareilles and Brandon Victor, you know, like all these amazing people. It's like, oh my God. So I was a little nervous to say the least. And so we go and, you know, the three of us get into a car and we go out there and we meet him there at the rehearsal, at the recording studio. And it's just the four of us in this space with a piano player and like a audio tech working in the booth. And he's teaching us these songs and, or this song. And he's like, no, Sarah, when you sing the E-flat, make sure that you sing it with, you know, and he's doing this very Andrew Lloyd Webber thing. And every now and then he do this and do that. And then he keep going. And I was like, wait, what? And we're kind of looking like, what is this? So he has this kind of strange affliction where he overproduces tears. His eyes overproduce tears, they water. So he, instead of having a napkin, I'm sure at one point in his life, he probably had like a napkin, but he just, at this point, he's like, I don't care. I can do whatever I want, I'm Angela Weber. And so he wipes his eyes and he eats his tears. So Angela Webber eats his own tears. Like, he totally, you know, it's a very humanizing thing that I noticed about him. And like, as soon as that happened, I was like, oh, cool. Now we can do this. You know, like, now, it's like, now I'm comfortable. You know what I mean? Like,
yes, like, we're on equal playing field now.
Yeah, well, kind of, you know, but like, he's definitely a human being, you know?
You saw him as a human being in that moment, which is like really cool. Seeing someone who's like a legend and has written so much famous music in Broadway shows, like
100%. I always tell people as a joke, if I ever do like a cabaret or like a 54 Below show or something like that, we call it Angela Webber Eats His Own Tears.
Well, and you'd have to invite him, like send him an invite. Be like, I don't know if you can make it, but here.
Yeah, right. Watch me get a cease and desist. Like, I got to stop telling the story now because he's like, I don't want anybody to know. You know?
No. Did he ever like say anything like to you like about your singing?
Yeah. I mean, he was pretty focused on like, you know, making sure that this thing was going to be a success, because it was. We were doing a lot of new things. This was a very ambitious project that, by all accounts, should not have worked. Like, I mean, our director David Laveau, right before we went on for the live taping, he said, "Listen, things have gone so well that if you guys don't mess something up tonight, I'm gonna be very upset at you." He's like, "You all better." He's like, "You." He's like, "This none of this is supposed to work as well as it did. So if you guys don't screw something up, I'll be pissed." You know, that kind of thing.
Hey, and it worked.
Yeah, yeah.
And it had so many cool effects on, like, on the screen watching from TV. It was just, like, it was hard to look away. Because of all of everything that was going on, the lighting, the ensemble as a whole. Like, it gives you chills. And it's also, like, everyone who normally doesn't maybe get to go to New York to see shows gets to see a musical. From their comfort of their own home, which is also really cool and special.
Yeah, 100%. And you know, it's live. It's happening then and there in that moment. There's nothing's being filtered. Nothing is being altered. It was 100% just us. You know what I mean? And so there's this like, I don't know how we did it. I honestly don't know how or why. We were able to do this thing without it just falling apart. I it blows my mind.
Well, and it was definitely advertised as the main TV event of the night that night.
Totally.
So the ratings afterwards were probably really fun to look at.
Oh God, they were amazing. Yeah, it was a massive success.
So out of the Broadway roles that you've done, going back to Broadway, what role I mean, I know you want to originate a role, but what role would you want to take on again as your present day self?
A role that I've already played?
Yeah, on Broadway.
Oh, man. I mean, I got to play Drew again in Rock of Ages at the Pittsburgh Civic Light Opera.
Ooh.
Last year, or God, not last year, because we've been in a pandemic for a year, but in 2019, they called and said, "Hey, you know, we're doing Rock of Ages for our summer, season, and we'd love you to come and reprise your role." And so I said, "Sure." So I got to go do it again. So it was strange because it had been years, you know. And so all of a sudden, I'm stepping into this show and into this role that I'd done so many times, and I was like falling right back into it, just like no time had passed. It was pretty incredible.
Was it Pittsburgh CLO?
Yeah, yeah.
They have good theater in Pittsburgh. I went there for a show last year, and
it's massive. It's huge.
Fantastic theater. I wasn't expecting Pittsburgh to have like, I don't know. You just don't expect like the cities between NYC and LA to have massive theater like that.
What show did you see?
I went to see Grease last year. Or
oh,
whatever. No. What? 2020 didn't count.
I think that was the same year as Rock of Ages, actually.
Yeah.
So my good friend Jackie Burns was in that production.
Yes. Yeah. It was so good. So I have to bring up, I'm excited to bring up FTR, because you've also done FTR productions.
Yes.
Being based in LA, I know FTR. So it's a huge West Coast thing. You've done Love Actually and Baz in Vegas.
Yeah.
Love Actually in LA, Baz in Vegas. How did you hear about FTR and get involved in FTR?
They had, so for Baz, they had come to the city and auditioned for this Baz, this new Baz Luhrmann review that I was like, that sounds pretty badass. So I went and auditioned for that. And that's kind of how that's kind of how this whole relationship started. Was I had just auditioned for them when they came to New York looking for Christians for their Moulin Rouge segment.
Wow. So yeah. What was your initial reaction when like you heard what FTR was? For those who don't know, it's like they combine movies that Baz Luhrmann has done and like put them all in a musical. And it's like something that's rarely done, I feel like, in musical theater.
So for me, it was, I'm a massive film score nerd. I love film scores. You know, John Williams, Danny Elfman, Hans Zimmer, you know, James Newton Howard, I mean, Howard Shore, all these kind of storytellers and these are our modern day, you know, composers, our Mozarts, our Beethovens. They're, you know, they tell you how to feel when you're watching a movie, quite honestly. And when I got this, when I kind of realized what they were trying to do, what they were attempting to do and doing it successfully, which was kind of combine the world of film and theater and, you know, kind of using film scores as a way to bridge that gap. I was like, that's brilliant. That's a really damn good idea. So that's kind of how I got, you know, turned on to what it is they were doing. And I really, really, really wanted to see the Scorsese one. I had some friends that were in that. And I'm so bummed that I didn't get to see that one, but.
When theater comes back, I'm sure that show will come back because FTR is huge in LA and like something that's been happening for years. So,
do you know Justin Bortoletti?
I saw him in one of the FTR shows. I don't know him, but I saw him in one of the FTR shows.
He lives like right there. He lives like four houses down from me, right here. Oh. And Kennedy Coggle, you know, my Super U co-star, yeah. She lives like literally across the street from me here. It's so crazy. This is like, this whole area is just full of performers.
It's the Broadway street.
Yeah.
Musical theater street.
But I love them. That whole company is so great. For the record, it's just, you know, everyone that's involved is just so professional and so sweet and just so passionate about what they're doing. And, They've been very, very good friends, and I miss them very much.
Was the Las Vegas audience fun to perform in for?
No.
No? Were they pretty, like, out of it maybe during the show, or?
They were quiet. They were a lot of them were quiet. They were either quiet or hammered.
Yeah, maybe they didn't know how, like, theater etiquette.
Yeah, you know, Las Vegas is a strange beast because musical theater doesn't tend to do well there because casinos don't want people to have their attention span, you know, focused on a 2.5 hour musical. Yeah, exactly. Focus on getting them back to the casino, get them gambling, you know, get them spending money because like, even the Broadway shows like Phantom and Jersey Boys and Mamma Mia, all the shows that were in Las Vegas, they're all 90-minute versions because they didn't want people to be off the casino floor for that long. So it's tricky. And so Baz, I feel like, was like a pageantry show for the Venetian to have. They were like, hey, we are a little more highbrow. We have this thing, you know, so like it would be like an incentive for some of their high rollers. You know, they would say, hey, here's some tickets to this show. And so they'd be like, oh, okay. And so a lot of people that were coming to see it weren't necessarily there because they were seeking it out, but not because they love theater, exactly. And so it was a lot of foreign audiences too, which is fine, but like, culturally, especially in a lot of Asian cultures, they don't clap during shows. This actually famously is what it happens a lot at Phantom and at Wicked, because those shows have been running for such a long time that they have such a massive following in other countries, and so a lot of people from China and Japan, they'll come and they'll reserve all of their applause for the end of the show, and then they'll go wild, they'll go nuts. But it's a little it's so weird to perform for those kinds of audiences because you're like, ooh, do they like this show? I don't know. I can't really tell.
It's kind of like sporting events. Like people run, like people who perform for audiences normally like the applause and the cheer and like people being involved. And it's like when an audience isn't involved, it's like, what is happening? Or when there's no audience, like this year for sporting events, like why is it so quiet?
Well, not just that, but also like there are built-in moments, you know, like, okay, so we know to expect a reaction here from the audience, and we don't want them to miss what comes right after that. So we'll allow for a little bit of time to breathe. And then all of a sudden you're doing that, and then there's nothing that happens. And then so you have to jump right back into the action because your expectation is that they're going to be applauding or they're going to be, oh, you know, like they're going to have some kind of reaction. And then when that doesn't happen, it can really throw off your performance, you know?
So I'm sure Love Actually in LA was a little more fun to perform in because the audience was more involved, probably.
Yeah, it was. Love Actually was so great. I love that movie so much. It was difficult because so much of the movie was being shown.
Yes.
Did you see Love Actually?
I forgot what year I saw that one in. I saw the one the year before it went into the big space in the small room at the Wallace, and then I saw it the next year at the Wallace when it was in the big room and the movie was playing at the same time, and they were very different versions.
Yeah. So did you see it with Rumor Willis?
No, I didn't.
Was Ruby in it?
Yes.
Okay, so that was the year after I did it.
First year I saw it. And then I don't think she was in it the second year I saw it.
Was Steve Kazee in it when you saw it?
Yes. And Ashley was in it. And Olivia Harris was still in it.
And Bea Slade?
Yes.
So that's the one that I did. That's the year that I was in it.
Okay. Wait. What? I forgot what year it was, but...
I played Mark. I had short hair, but I was the guy with the signs.
Yeah, I think it was that year.
So actually this guitar is from that performance.
Really?
Yeah. I fell in love with this guitar. They bought it for me for the show. And I was like, can I have this guitar? Can I buy it from you? It was my first ask was, and they were like, you can just take it, just have it. And I was like, are you serious? I'm like, yes. So no. I love them.
You're like, I love them so much. I'm just gonna
Shane and Steve and
props from them.
yeah, exactly.
And it's such a good show because it's like gets you into the Christmas spirit, probably the performing it. So
100%.
I can imagine how fun it is.
That was my first time working in LA ever too.
Really?
Yeah.
Was it your first time in California or no?
No, because I was in Sacramento for a summer, yeah.
Okay. But first time in LA, wow. Got to come back for a tour sometime now because people have seen you in FTR. So
I'd love to do Rock of Ages in LA. That'd be a lot of fun.
Yes. I mean, FTR fans, once they see someone in a show, I feel like they're like, okay, they've got to be in more shows in LA. You know?
So actually, Ruby and I are in a show that's in development right now.
Oh, wait, what show?
It's a new musical. It's called Mozart. It's about Mozart.
Oh my gosh, you know so much.
So, yep. I got my hands in all the pots. Same. So, I'm playing Mozart. Ruby is playing Nannerl Mozart, who is Mozart's more talented sister. And the show is mostly about their relationship and the fact that she was kind of... it was kind of demanded upon her that she not pursue a career in music because she was a woman.
Okay.
And so what that did to her, what that did to her family dynamic, their relationship with her and her brother. And so it's pretty damn good. It's really, really good. So be on the lookout for that one.
I'm excited. You're doing a lot. I'm excited to hear you sing more and get more well known than you already are. Like, and see more people being like, this guy, this boy.
Oh man.
Like, let's talk about his rock voice more. So, speaking of shows you've done, you have a great list of shows and roles that you've already done. What role would you like to take on in the future besides originating a new role?
I'd love to do Tommy.
Okay.
Tommy, yeah, that's a big one.
Would you have ever thought about Next to Normal?
I think that ship has passed for me. I think I'm too old to play Gabe now.
But would you have ever thought about that?
Yeah, I would love.
I could totally see it.
I get compared to Aaron a lot, which is great and very, you know, and I love that, but at the same time, it's like, well, I don't want to be compared to Aaron, you know what I mean? Because I like what we do is very different, you know what I mean? Like I try to do, he's got this incredible like pop musical theater thing going on, and I don't really want to fit into that category, you know what I mean? But
the rock vibe.
I want to be the rock guy, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, that's a role that I would have loved to have done. It's such a good role. It's such great songs.
Yes, for sure. It's also an emotional one, like the one you described earlier. It's an emotional story, but good songs. So what's the funniest thing that's ever happened to you on stage? This is my favorite question to ask.
Oh boy. So, God, how many times have I told this story? So when I was doing Rock of Ages, there is this scene at the very beginning of the show where Lonnie, the narrator, he's all the way downstage and he's talking to the audience and like getting them hyped up for the show, you know, like explaining, like setting up the world, essentially setting up the world. And so my character comes out and Drew comes out and he kind of like does this big, like, I ain't never going home, this whole thing. And then he, you know, runs into the bar and then he throws his guitar down. He picks up a broom and he starts like sweeping up the bar. Like, you know, so my whole thing was, I get in the bar, I'm gonna grab the broom from over the bar, and like I would like swing it over my shoulder and like start like jamming out like I was like at a rock concert, like sweeping up the floor, right? And so I don't know why, but after like some 400 or 500 performances, I grab the broom and I hoist it over my shoulder and I accidentally let go, and it goes whoosh, 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 bam! It smashes into a neon Corona beer bottle sign and explodes all over the stage. Glass explodes all over the stage. Sparks are flying all over the place. And I'm just like,
And this is like the show.
This is like the beginning of the show. It's like the first like 2 minutes of the show, and there's glass all over the place. And I'm like, duh. And all these women are about to come on stage barely wearing anything in high heels, and they're supposed to like dance all sexy and stuff. And like, I'm like, what do I do? So this dance, Nika Zhang, actually one of our amazing dancers, came out and was like, give me the broom. And she like, she did this like sexy dance and she like, you know, swept up the floor. And, oh my God. But and they never let me live it down, of course.
You're like, that was supposed to happen. The audience that day, this is actually new in the show.
In fact, they never replaced it. They never replaced that sign because they were like, we want you to remember what you did, you know?
Or they were like, in case he does it again, like then it doesn't matter. It's already broken.
Yep.
It already happened, so we don't have to worry about anything breaking again if the broom hits it.
And one time in Spiderman, my I was supposed to be lifted off of a bed, and only half of only one line was clipped in, so I got lifted on one side and just kind of like spun around on one side for a good minute until they stopped the show to fix it.
Was that scary to like trust the contraptions that like made you fly in Spiderman?
No, it was only ever really scary because it all depends on you. As long as you're doing what you're supposed to do, you're gonna be fine. So I was only ever scared. I wouldn't even say the word scared. I was only ever nervous or worried if I was just so tired that day for some reason that I was like not gonna be, like there was a couple flips that I had to do, and if I couldn't get all the way over, then they'd have to stop the show because I'd be dangling upside down for a while, right?
Yeah.
So there was a couple days where I was just like, man, I'm so tired. I don't know if I can do this flip today. But I did them.
Did you have to sing while you were doing that?
Oh God, yeah. There was this song called "Bouncing Off the Walls," where like, and I, like as Peter Parker, like I wake up with my powers and I'm in my bedroom and the walls and the floor and the roof all move independent of each other in that scene. And so I would be on my bed and I'd be like, something else is coming up inside of me, something flip. It's coming deep inside of me, down on that, like upside down on the ceiling while singing, bouncing off the wall.
My God.
Yeah. Like I go from the bed and I jump up and flip and be upside down on the ceiling and then flip and back down onto the bed and then flip over to this wall here, push out with my feet, do a rotation to this wall and then do another flip and do another rotation down to the ground and like then do like a spin in the air and flip over. All while singing, like, wow, jump, and not, you know, like, it was crazy. It was crazy.
Meanwhile, I can barely walk and, like, chew gum at the same time. Like, it's fine.
It was a lot. It was 6 weeks of physical training for that role.
Jeez. And wow. A lot of exercise during the show.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. It's like, who needs the gym when you're doing all that you're doing on stage?
I could eat whatever I wanted. It was awesome.
That best part of the job, eat whatever you want.
100%.
So in an industry like this, you have to work on self-confidence because like you get told no in audition rooms so much, I feel like. And like, and it takes a while before you get jobs. So how do you work on self-confidence in this industry?
It's the single hardest thing that we have to endure and go through in this industry. Every celebrity, every person in this business hears no all the time, yeah. Right? You just don't ever realize it because you're only seeing them do the things that they've gotten yeses for, right? So, you know, it's never easy. It's always hard. It's always a struggle. I think for myself, I find that surrounding myself with people that aren't in the industry and kind of having other things to focus on, other things, other hobbies, other interests, is what really helps me kind of abandon that devastatingly, you know, depressing world of rejection, quite honestly, yeah. Because it's a lot, you know, it's a lot because how can you not take it personally? They're literally saying no to you, you know what I mean, to what you're bringing to the table. But you know, 90% of auditioning has nothing to do, of casting has nothing to do with what it is that you brought to the table. It's just that you just weren't the guy, you know, or the girl. You weren't the person that they were looking for. And, you know, it's hard to convince somebody when as soon as you walk in the room, they go, oh, no. Like, oh, I see. No, not him. You know what I mean?
And then they have one in mind.
Yeah. And then you've got to audition for them. And like, they may go, oh, well, actually, that was kind of cool. I like what he did there. Maybe I'll have him come back in. Yeah. Well, that was kind of cool. I like what he did there, but I really was hoping that this character would be, you know, have a beard. I don't know, whatever, you know? So it's a really strange world. It's a really strange world to navigate, and it is not easy. It is very difficult.
How long did it take you to realize that, like, most casting directors, when you walk in a room, like, want you to be the one that books the role? You know, and like once the next person who walks into the room to be, like, to fill the shoes of the character they're trying to cast.
It's not just the casting director; it's everybody behind the table. You know, they all want this to be quick. They want the first 10 people to fill those 10 slots. That way, their job is done. You know. It didn't take me very long to learn that that's how it goes, and that's what they want. But there is something that I think happens a lot of times in casting where they will say, like a casting director will believe that, say they believe I'm the right person for the job, right? Yeah. Then they'll pad the audition with people who may not be right for it before me to set up the casting, the creative team for the person that they think is the most right. That kind of happens a lot, I think. But, you know, I will say that 95% of the auditions that I've gone on, 95% of the rooms that I've auditioned in have been just like you can feel the energy that they're like, oh, please, please be the guy, you know, please let this be it. You know what I mean? And you can tell when it's going well, you can tell when you're the guy. And that's a good feeling.
I can imagine. It's like, okay, yes, there's a good chance that I can get this role.
Yeah.
So is there anything else that you've been working on in quarantine that you'd want to promote?
Yeah, so I've got a lot going on. This Super U, the musical, go to superuthemusical.com or superumusical.com. I'm not sure, but they have an Instagram page. They've got Twitter. They've got everything. You can find the demo on Spotify. Be on the lookout for Mozart. It is going to be so good. We did a reading for it back in, I don't want to say it was July, maybe August. It was myself, Ruby Lewis, Anthony Rapp, Robert Cuccioli, just to name a couple people. It was so good. Mozart. Oh, I've been doing, oh my God. So I did this. It's like a 12 and a half hour musical radio drama podcast called The World to Come.
Ooh.
It is a post-apocalyptic comedy musical in the vein of, you know, Rocky Horror Show meets like Toxic Avenger meets like, it's just, it is so weird and funny and cool. And you have to check it out. It's called The World to Come. It is an audio, it is a audio only musical. So it's, I mean, the cast is amazing. The creative team is amazing. Written by Eric Ransom, Andy Peterson wrote the music. Rachel Klein directed. It is really, really, really good. Especially if you're a geek, because it is all about being the ultimate fan. You know what I mean? It's like there's just like a lot of fandom in there. That was a lot of fun. We worked on that. I'm still working on that, actually. We're recording new songs for it all the time. What else?
I'll put the link down in the description too, because like God knows everyone's going on walks these days. And like listening to stuff on walks, like podcast, in podcast form, like a musical, that's the best thing to listen to on a walk.
Yeah, check out The World to Come. You'll love it.
Well, that's amazing. Where can people follow you on social media to find out other things you've been up to during this time and things that are coming up in the future for you?
You can follow me on Instagram at Justin M. Sargent, JustinMSargent. And you know, I don't really do Twitter. I gotta get a TikTok going. Like everybody's on TikTok now.
You gotta get into the Bridgerton musical hashtag thing.
Yeah, I haven't watched Bridgerton yet, but I'm so excited to watch it. It looks so good.
I haven't watched it yet either. I was trying to watch it the other day, and then I like fell asleep or something. I like it was late. And I was like, okay, maybe I'm going to watch it like when I'm awake instead.
What have you been doing during this whole thing, during this whole quarantine?
Going on walks, doing this, listening to Broadway albums on repeat, hanging out with my family.
Yeah. What's your favorite musical?
Oh, huh?
Favorite musical.
Oh, that's so hard right now. I have so many. Wicked, duh. And I saw Hadestown during previews, and that was just like mind blowing.
Yeah, Hadestown's great.
It was mind blowing to watch.
Yep.
Are you also doing master classes with like a site like Artists and Beyond too?
With Artists and Beyond, also with Broadway Booker. I'm also, if you just want to send me like a DM on Instagram, whatever, like I also book my own through my own portal. I do voice lessons, acting coaching, audition prep, audition coaching. I do a lot of master classes just for like school systems, you know, just like a lot of Q&As, that kind of thing. Yeah, and a lot of the voice stuff that I talk about is a little different. I like to talk about cheating and brain trickery.
Okay.
I'll give you one quick little tip, real quick. Something that's gonna hopefully blow your mind, because you said you're a big you love Wicked. Okay.
Yes.
You've heard the song The Wizard and I a million times, right?
Yeah. Duh.
Can you pull it up real quick?
Wizard and I.
Yeah.
Let's see if it works.
Just the last 10 seconds. Just pull it up the last 10 seconds.
Wait, where should I play it from? Hold on. I can maybe play it from my phone.
Okay. So let me, while you're doing that, let me preface this by saying that in the world of musical theater, everybody cheats. Everybody cheats when they're singing. Everybody, including Idina Menzel. And she does it brilliantly in the song The Wizard and I. And I'll tell you why she does it after you hear what she does.
Okay, wait, when do you know the time code?
You go to the last 10 seconds of the song.
Okay, last 10 seconds.
Just...
Wait, can you hear it?
Yeah. Yeah. One more time. Just that last wizard and I. Just that last one.
I'm trying to like do the fast forward thing, the rewind thing.
Pause it. Okay, perfect.
I paused.
What is the name? What's the name of the song?
Wasn't it?
She doesn't say that at the end. She says the wizard and lie. The wizard and lie. Now listen.
Wait.
The wizard and lie.
What? I did hear it. You aren't lying. I did hear it.
So wow. There's a reason why she does this. Because the wizard and I is so hard to sing, especially when you're belting that crazy high note up there, right? And I. You are starting the and I with a diphthong, and you are stopping the word, and you're stopping everything that's coming out of your mouth, and then going right back into, and I'm sorry, not a diphthong, a glottal onset. And is a glottal onset, d is you're stopping everything from happening, and then back to a glottal onset, I. And if you say the wizard and I, you never actually have to stop the sound from coming out of your mouth. You just temporarily flick it with a flick of your tongue. You kind of temporarily stop that sound from coming out. If you do a hard D, it stops everything, and it just forces your anatomy to work so much harder. So a way to get around that is the wizard and lie, and you'll never know it. You never know because it sounds the same because you've heard a phrase a billion times already in the song. So she cheats. She does something
that's
gonna
be- know if you listen for that.
If you listen for that. But she has, and it's brilliant because she has to do this song 8 times a week, every single night. And it's stressful, it's strenuous, it's hard. So you have to look for places where you can go, okay, I can get away with this here because no one's ever gonna know. No one's ever gonna know, and it doesn't really matter because the vocal gymnastics are so impressive anyway.
Yeah, that's shocking. Boom. I had no clue.
Boom.
And that happens a lot?
More than you would possibly believe, yeah.
Wow, I'm so curious. I'm so interested in looking up on what shows that's happened in. Whoa, that's an amazing tidbit.
Yay!
So, lastly, I'm going to put all the links and stuff you've mentioned down in the description for anyone who's listening or watching to go to and find. So lastly, what are you looking forward to when theater can come back in a live setting, not virtual?
I'm looking forward to that first rehearsal. I'm looking forward to that first, you know, day of tech. I'm looking forward to that first audience. I'm looking forward to hearing people coming into the theater. I'm looking forward to sitting down in a seat and watching the lights come down and watching my friends up on stage doing what they love. It's irreplaceable. It's completely irreplaceable. And I think we're learning that as a culture now. And, I know there's a lot of fear about people, you know, are saying, well, are people going to want to come back to the theater? Because are they going to be too scared to be that close to people? And I say, hell yes.
Yes. Because we've been without human interaction, or most human interaction, for so long that it's like, we miss it. Even if like you're not a big fan of the human interaction and you're kind of an introvert.
Yep.
You miss it too.
Even if you have to wear a mask in the theater, you know, like people are going to go. People are going to come. They're going to flock. They miss it. They love it. They want it.
Look, I don't think anyone's the biggest fan of masks, but like if that's what it takes for theater to come back, like mask wearing, I'll do it any day.
I'll tell you what though, you know, in the winter, they're actually kind of great because it kind of keeps you warm, you know?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I figured that out. And then I'm like, okay, I can get on this. Like, instead of wearing a scarf to cover your mouth, you can wear a mask.
Yeah.
Well, anyways, thank you for coming on and talking to me on this and sharing that tidbit about The Wizard and I and other cheats and shows. Like, that's...
Well, I'm sorry if I've ruined that song forever for you now.
No, that's mind-blowing, and I love facts like that in theater, and I'm going to listen for that. And I'm going to be like, guess what? People, like, they're not actually saying what you think they're saying.
It's all a lie.
It's a lie, pun intended. Thanks for watching this episode of Backstage with Becca B. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Becca B Talks TV. Or for more exclusive content from this interview and more, you can follow me on Instagram and Facebook at Backstage with Becca B. Make sure to subscribe to my channel and like this video. Or if you're listening on Apple Podcasts, go ahead and give me a 5-star rating. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye!